And then what's anxiety? Then I've talked already about depression. Anxiety, on the other hand, is very different in that anxiety can be a separate illness. It can go with depression, and usually depression and anxiety go together. If you're depressed, you get anxious. And if you're anxious, you definitely go into depression. Definitely, must have at a certain percentage of the time. 25-30% of the population has anxiety. And India, by the way, as she had commented on it, India has the highest statistics for suicide. In depression, the worst case scenario is suicide, also suicide, planning suicide. And Bangalore has the highest statistics for
suicide.
A study by the Britishers, I think it was an article in the British Journal of Psychiatry, but enhanced guys got very upset saying you've done it all wrong. But I think it's kind of true. I think it's true.
And it addresses a larger section of the younger people.
And we are very young.
Not the higher upper bracket, it's quite the lower age bracket for younger
20s and 30s. So I'll talk to you about anxiety. It's a feeling of unease, it's a feeling of fear, it's a feeling that I'm not accomplishing something I'm supposed to be good at. So that's like very basic definition. Now I'll just give you an example, okay? 25-year-old comes to the a woman, comes to the psychiatrist's office with her mother. She looks embarrassed and tense. And she says, you know, the cardiologist sent me to you. This happened. He said, I don't need to see him, I need to see you. All my tests are perfectly fine. I've done all the labs in the last 3 months. But in the last few months, every single day, out of the blue, I'm just sitting and doing my thing. My heart starts beating fast. I can't breathe. My hands start shaking. I start having palpitations. And I start sweating. And it's very embarrassing. Because everybody must be noticing what's wrong with ma'am. You know, she's like behaving like a bunny or something. You know, like shaking. Ma'am's hand is shaking. She's holding the papers. It's shaking. She's not breathing. Her voice is tremulous. And of course, the woman thought she's having a heart attack. You know, because you feel like you can't breathe, you're choking. And of course, you go to the everybody runs to the cardiologist. Slightly less stigmatizing, you know. It's not a mental health issue, I'll go to the cardiologist. And the cardiologist promptly says, everything has been done. It's not my issue. Go see the mental health doctor. And they're like, really? Repeated attacks of fear. Intense worry when the next attack is going to happen. Avoiding places where people can see you have this panic attack. This is a panic attack. It is a form of anxiety disorder. Because anxiety disorder is not a single thing. It's multiple, and I'm not going to go through all of them today. I just go through two of them. It is central. And this is a panic attack. It's very common. 10-20% of the population has it.
Lack of oxygen.
Yeah, so it's not really lack of oxygen. It's a kind of fear that has started you into a physiological cycle. Actually, your heart is fine now. You should, of course, not have, you know, heart problems, and you should not be having a heart attack.
But some physical problems create
Let's say
we went to a mental health was directed to a mental health person, and he was studying, and then they found that he couldn't really life on his epidural process.
Yeah,
so he is a
real issue.
Yeah, that's a real issue.
So of course you should clarify, is this a real physical issue, is the issue not coming from just psychiatric? Usually this stuff is cleared by the ENT doctor, it's cleared by the cardiologist, the cardiologist first. Go ahead and clear, see the medical doctor, let him do a basic ECG, check your pulse, check your blood pressure. Yeah. Even if that's not showing up anything, and you know, then there will be. And the evidence says, yeah, it's like, you know, for doctors especially, wow, mom is doing all this. If mom is at home, of course mom is doing a lot in the house. But if she's also working, there is even more enough in adding, wow, I can do this too.
And make it sensitive also.
Yeah. And see, you know, at least in the US and UK, when they go and stay in a daycare, they learn to do a lot of things on their own. Very quickly.
They appreciate.
In India, not necessarily. Okay. So then, I'm going to go to, sorry, yeah, this is a little hard to do. I'm going to go to the part which is about assume that you have depression, let's assume that you have anxiety, let's assume that you have social phobia. What are you supposed to do? Most people do what? They don't go see a psychiatrist. Let me tell you, there are about 2,500 odd psychiatrists in India. 3,000. That's it. For a population of 1 billion something. That's it. So there is really nothing in the country. And we don't talk about urban. The whole of India has not at all urban. This is Bangalore, you're lucky. Actually, all of them are here. Rest of India has nobody. So we are lucky to be in a city where there are at least psychiatrists, definitely counselors, some really good counselors are out there. So what are the things I can do for myself? And so let's assume that there are 3,500 psychiatrists in the whole country. And there are less than that counselors in the country. And there are even less social workers in the country. So psychologists are less than psychiatrists. And social workers who also do counseling and who help in social situations are even less than that. So we really don't have any, and the funding is almost zero. Healthcare funding is not very good. Mental health funding is about barely existing. So what can you do as a person who say has at least some amount, you're not suicidal, and you've tried? There is evidence that if you can think positively, you probably will move a little ahead. I'm not saying that start thinking positively about everything, like crash the car, it's okay, yeah.
That's okay. Sometimes they do.
That also happens. But to think positively on a general basis, like I'm not an optimist. I'm pretty much a pessimist. And you know, at least I'm aware. So my big thing is not, I am doing this lifetime. I'm not getting anywhere near where I probably, like the Guruji who teaches the class, who is this lifetime I may not get. I'm aware I'm a pessimist. So I try as much as I can. But if you are an optimist, lucky you. And if you're not and you're like me, work on it. And what are the advantages? The advantages, increased lifespan if you want that. Lower rates of depression, lower levels of distress, greater resistance to infections, reduced risk of death from heart disease, and better coping when you have a stressful situation. So overall, being a little, working towards optimism, even if you're not, my husband's like the optimist, he's like nothing but optimism. So that can help us, you know, he's humbling. Somebody is helping being positive. But it does help your physical health as much as this. And remember this, if you notice, people who've been under stress a while also start to catch infections. They fall ill a lot, more fever.
They also, their immunity is so low at base level that anything that's going to be around in the air is going to catch.
Yeah.
Dr. Sabina has taken time off work, so I would appreciate it if you had thought to open that chain for the question.
And if you don't know if you are a positive kind of person or a negative kind of person, these are the ways you know. Filtering. You magnify a negative aspect of a situation and filter out the positive. For example, you had a great day. You completed your task ahead of time. You did everything correctly. You were like A1. And you forgot a chota sa step. You know, one thing you most of it. But you don't focus on all the good stuff you've done. And even the fact that your boss gave you a pat on the back or your colleague in charge said, took a job, you focus on that one crap ass thing you didn't do. So that's called filtering. So which information are you letting into your mind? And remember, this is like my thing when patients come to me. See, the mind is like a horse. Okay? You hold the reins, it will go where you want it to go. You let go the reins, it will do. You know, it'll eat grass on the way, it'll go somewhere you never wanted to go. So hold the reins of your mind. Mind is extremely powerful. It can do things to you that you can't imagine. And if you don't respect it and take it seriously, it won't do anything you want. So body, I'm less bothered. People come to my hospital and get blood tests and diabetes and blood pressure. But it's healthy. I'm so happy to come back next year, executive gold health checkup. I will not say anything against my hospital, but That's not it. That is not where the back to the bucket. Something bad occurs and you blame you yourself and say this is my fault. In case of like, you know, it happens a lot actually. You have a supposed word with your friends, everything is set, kai baar mein milenge, almost you've got your dress ready, all of this cancelled.
You say this is because nobody wanted to meet me.
And that's it, you are both meet each other. You're like, nobody. And then you're miserable. And if you keep doing this often enough, people will start avoiding you. Because you're miserable all the time and people don't really want to hang out with you. And then you think that, suppose you were going to get a coffee, you went, just parked your car in some corner where there's no parking, you jumped into the car, you went to McDonald's, you picked up a coffee, you went to pick up a coffee and the coffee was not ready. And you decide the rest of my day is going to be crap, just like this. And that's called catastrophizing. It's a very common thing. Maybe what? The rest of my life? And there are these people that see things in black and white. See, life is, and again, this is, you may be the kind that sees things in black and white, that's okay. But be aware you are seeing things in black and white. The world runs on grays and many other colors. But it certainly doesn't run black and white. That means either everything is good or everything is bad. If the world was so easy, I don't know if any of you read these sci-fi books about the future. I read a lot of these teenage books, you know, about divergent and convergent. These books are about the future, you know, where everything is precisely organized. If you have a certain mentality, you belong to this clan. But it's not like that, no. You don't live like that. So nothing, so you have to at least, and if you polarize, you're in for trouble. You're thinking either it's black and white, is maybe she did it because she was just having a bad day. Not because she is bad in general. Not because she wanted to be rude or she wanted to be mean to me. It was just a bad day. That is so much easier, and it's not easy. It's something you might have to work on. So what the point of this positive thinking is, it's not something that comes automatically. It's not something you're born with. I'm not. I work on it at least. So if you're not an optimist, work on it. So positive thinking is not really, positive thinking is actually a whole, it has a lot more than just saying positive thinking. I think it is, positive thinking is when you don't judge yourself, you don't judge others. So when you're not judging anything around you, I think it also brings in this mindfulness issue. So positive thinking is not the, from now onwards, you know, sub good. It's good if you keep telling, I tell my patients when you get up in the morning, tell yourself one good thing about yourself. And they laugh at me. I can say it aloud, stand in front of the mirror and say, I'm going to have a good day. Or I'm looking really nice today. Anything positive. And people laugh. They're like, are you crazy? I'm not doing stuff like standing on the mirror. But actually that has an effect on the brain. And that effect is actually in the neuronal, if you want the biology of it. Nerve connections change based on what you tell the brain. Remember, the brain and the mind is telling the brain stuff. The mind has the power. So if you repeatedly tell the brain that I'm useless, I'm no good, I'm worthless, everything is horrible, your brain is going to form nerve connections to solidify that information. So now you need to tell your brain new stuff. You've got to tell your brain, you know what, I'm a good person, I'm going to try to have a good day today, I'm going to try to have a day maybe with not too much of anxiety. It's okay if the road is crap and all the men on the road are trying to get you to have an attitude. It's okay, these things happen. If you try, you probably get placed. And positive thinking, what she's talking about, has two or three different components, and I'm not the expert, but I can tell you this much. if you want to get to the level of positive thinking, one is stop judging yourself. Every time you find yourself saying to yourself, "Ki I'm so not," stop. Remember, every time you tell yourself something that you're not or not good at or worthless at, it's a new thing your brain has learned. And you're trying to tell your brain good things. Don't judge yourself. Don't judge other people. Try. And that's one of the things I'll get to. When you stop judging and then you become mindful of your environment, which is, what is mindfulness? Mindfulness is basically becoming aware of yourself, aware of your environment, aware of all the thoughts going through your mind and being in the moment. And what does that mean? Basically, at least in my understanding of it, you are supposed doing your job. You find that the mind says, mother-in-law ne keh diya, today guests are coming home, I need to make this. And the mind has this ability of multitasking, that it thinks it's very good at. Actually, multitasking doesn't work very well for the brain. So see, if you can stay in the moment of what you're doing, and stay for as long as it takes, nothing is going to happen by you multitasking in your brain. Stick with the moment, stick with what you're doing, and then move on. And that's what's meditation. Right? Whatever you do it, enjoyment is the next level, but at least be in it. Be in it. You're typing this letter and da 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 da. It's neither fun, you don't know what you did. And you won't feel a sense of satisfaction if you were doing something mindful. If I'm giving my talk and all I'm thinking about is the next stop which I have to go to in the next up and up, I would be less stressing, I wouldn't have fun talking here. So it's better to focus on the task at hand and enjoy it. If you're able to get to it, focus, and then at the next level, as she says, have fun with it. You're getting to a point of whatever nirvana or whatever else is there. This lifetime you're going to get to it, wow. But at least work on it. And that's what's positive is. The whole positive attitude is all about judgment. The biggest thing is about judgment. Self-judgment, judgment of others, so much wasted time. Yeah, and I'll get to that. So actually I skipped that because that I hear. And you know, many of the young people that I speak to in IT sector, they tell me, you want me to become a yogi, do mindfulness, do meditation, do yoga. I say, no, that is not what I'm saying. I think essentially most people want to be good. Mindfulness will get you there. Non-judgmental stance, what is called radical acceptance, accepting the way they are, all these will slowly help you. These are words that a lot of enlightened people use. I myself don't understand them very well, but in time I've started to get some sense of what it means as I see more and more patients in different situations. But try these things. It's so much less burden on the mind to not have to worry about usne kyun kaha, maine aise kab kaha, all the drama.
Analyzing thoughts.
Do not! Leave the analyzing to me. So, you know, one of the things that I miss, which you guys are asking me repeatedly, is, gosh, oh. So, somebody asked me exercise. So, stress, depression, anxiety. The simple answer, man. The simple answer is eat healthy, exercise, cultivate relationships, volunteer, and sense of humor. If you don't have one, get one. Okay? Yeah, yeah. Develop one. Do something. Do something. Because not everybody is born funny. That's not the plan. So try to form one. When I joined psychiatry, they told us this. They told us this. You don't have one, you better develop one. That time I was like, seriously, these Americans. And exercise, I don't have evidence for yoga. There is some Indian data about, obviously Indian data, again it's not, you know, slam dunk evidence that yoga makes X better.